I'm going to go to Luke chapter 2. Everybody say the sign of the manger. And we had mentioned here a couple weeks ago that of all signs the Lord gave to the shepherds, and this is prophesied in the Old Testament, they were told they'd find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Everybody say wrapped in swaddling clothes? Lying in a manger. That's a sign. It was a sign that they would look for. And I want to read in Luke chapter 2, verse 4, these verses. And I just love how the word of the Lord all fits together, as we'll show you as we study and read this morning. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was out of the house of David, and or rather house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife. Notice they called Mary Joseph's wife, and they weren't married yet. You imagine getting engaged to somebody, and right from the engagement, you're husband and wife, but you're not married yet. Well, that's the way it was back then. An espousal was a real serious engagement. And you actually had to divorce before you were even married if you wanted to break up. And that actually crossed Joseph's mind when he found out Mary was with child. But anyhow, it was all straightened out. The angel came, had a dream. Angel appeared to Joseph. And so time came now for the child to be born, right at the time the world was being taxed. I often think of that spiritually speaking. This whole world has been taxed by sin. And right in that time, Jesus Christ came to set us free. Amen. How many remember when the Lord said, "Let there be light"? What state was the world in, according to Genesis 1 and 2? It was void. How's it say? Without form and void. Jesus is the light of the world, and God said again, "Let there be light," and Jesus was born right in the middle of Israel. That was without form and void, and darkness was in Israel. The religious leaders were so corrupt, and they weren't honest. They weren't living right at all, not leading the people properly. But anyway, there's messages all through this. And so his espoused wife being great with child, and so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered while they were there. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And down in verse 12, "And this shall be a sign to you." Here is the Lord's angels talking to the shepherds out in Bethlehem. "You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger." The manger was a sign. A sign is something that's a token. And Bethlehem in English means house of bread. Does anybody know what a manger actually is? What's a manger? It's a food trough. Here in the house of bread, there was a food trough. And in that food trough, Jesus was laid. And what's the message? There's the bread of life come to feed the whole world. How many are glad he brought us the bread from heaven? Praise God. Let's all believe God and let's pray together. Amen. I'm going to ask Glenn, pray for the message this morning.
Heavenly Father, we just want to thank you that we can gather here this morning to hear your word. And Lord, we just pray that you'd be with Mike as he speaks it. And just, your spirit would just fill this place and fill each one of us so that we would understand.
Thank you, Lord.
And know you better each time, every time we hear your word.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, just bless each one now. Bless our time together in Jesus.
Amen, amen. Bethlehem, that was no coincidence. The house of bread, that was the sort of like the southern Manitoba part of the country. That's where the bread basket was. That's where they had grain grown. And it was called the house of bread. And here Jesus is the bread of life, born in an area called the house of bread, and laid in a food trough. And shepherds were very familiar with mangers. These are from where the sheep would feed. And so that crib or that stall or that manger, the Greek word for manger means to eat. And of course, you understand animals would eat from those stalls. And it would definitely be a sign, though. There's a message. How many know that we are the sheep of his pasture? What does the 23rd Psalm call Jesus? The Lord is my shepherd. And as sheep, he leads us to feed. And here we are feeding on the bread of life, Jesus Christ. Praise God. But I really want to dig into this. How is this a sign? How do we feed on Jesus? What's that mean? Why did God use terminology like that? Why was he laying in a manger that you feed from? Why was it in the town of Bethlehem? How in the world do you feed on Christ? And there's so much in the Bible about this. And if you go to John 6 and verse 33, how many remember when Jesus fed the 5,000 and the loaves and the fishes were multiplied and 5,000 people were fed from just those few loaves and fishes? Well, I want to lay the story out, but before I do, in John 6 and 33, Jesus talks about the bread of God. For the bread of God is he. Everybody say, the bread is a he.
Bread is he.
It's a person. It's he which comes down from heaven and gives life unto the world. And so he's food. Now, in the Bible, when it says bread, it doesn't always mean like a loaf. It's food or meat, especially if the word meat, you think of chicken, you think of roast or something when you read meat. But in the Bible, it was just food, solid food. And so Jesus Christ is that bread, is that food. And if you go back earlier in the same chapter in John 6, let me show you how this all came about. Verse 2. A great multitude followed him because they saw his miracles, which he did on them that were diseased. And you find out there were 5,000 of these people. There's so many, he goes up on a hill and he tells the disciples, have them all sit down. And then the disciples say, what are we going to do with them? We've brought them all out here. It's only our responsibility. It's only what's right to feed them if you brought them here. He said, give me some bread and give me some fishes. Find something. And a little boy says, it might not be much, but it's all I've got. And how many know? It might not be much, but if it's all you've got, God will bless all you've got. It reminds me of the widow woman that gave a mite, a fraction of a penny. And Jesus said she just gave more than all the others put together because it was all she had. Don't worry of how much you have. You might say, I don't have many abilities. I might be like that person that's got one talent, and brother so-and-so's preaching on TV around the world. He's got like 20 talents. Don't worry. God's not going to judge you by comparing you with somebody else. He's going to judge you by how much you do with what you've got. Amen. How many know that that man that had that one talent buried it? He looked at the other one with two talents. He looked at the other one with five talents, and he looked at his one talent. And he says, I have nothing compared to these people. I'll just bury it and wait till the Lord comes and I'll give it to him the way he gave it to me. And that wasn't what the Lord wanted. You might only have one ability, but don't look at somebody that might have several more. If you do all that you can with your one talent, God might bless you more than he has blessed the one with five talents because they only maybe used two or three of them instead of all five. If you do everything you can with what you've got, praise God, God's going to bless you. Amen? Yeah. Hallelujah. And so Jesus multiplied that. And in verse 26, all these same people, this is verses and verses later, he got away from them lest they take him and make him a king after he multiplied all that food. And he went away and he went across the sea. He went to Capernaum and they were searching and searching. They were hunting. We've got to get him. We've got to find him. And notice Jesus gives us the answer why they looked for him. He said, verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me, not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. You ever stop and wonder what he's trying to tell the people there? You know, there could be crowds drawn to God, just like these crowds were drawn to Jesus. And what was it that Jesus was rebuking them for. You might say, well, they were coming to him. Isn't that good enough? They're coming to you, Lord. Yeah, but he said, why are you coming to me? You didn't even come because of the miracles. You came to me because I was giving food and you took advantage of me and you started fulfilling your natural desires. There's nothing wrong with being fed when we have a hunger to be fed. How many knows nothing wrong to be hungry? It's not a sin. But rather than come to Jesus because, oh my, he's the Messiah. He's surely the Messiah. We should be praising him. We should be giving him glory. This is the work of God that's come down into our land. And here he is right in front of us. That wasn't anything like that in their hearts. They were taking advantage of him, knowing it was a miracle. But that wasn't why they were there. I want more food. I want more food. Do you know, I have heard people, I know a woman, we were driving in a little trailer court in New Brunswick when we lived there for a few years. And a pastor that I was working with, I was assisting him in his church. And we drove by this trailer. I'll never forget. He said, Mike, you see that trailer? I said, yeah. He said, there's a woman living there right now. She was so full of cancer. And she'd been coming to our church. And God healed her, set her free. She was completely delivered of cancer. It was hopeless, he said. She was a miracle. But she doesn't serve God anymore. She doesn't come to church anymore. You never see her anymore. Could it be somebody that was similar to these people? That, oh, I want this, I want this. The real reason to come to Jesus, to worship him, to serve him, to love and obey him, is not in my heart. I just need healing because I'm going to die if I don't get healing. And I can get healed from him. You see, there's some people like that. Make sure you're following the Lord and obeying him. Make sure you're serving him. You're not just here even to just escape hell. How many know we could use God as a fire escape? I just don't want to go to hell. I'll serve you, Lord, because and there's no real desire to worship him. There's no real desire to serve him. And when things go wrong, I remember when 9/11 happened and the towers came down, people thought Armageddon was just the next week. And all of a sudden the churches filled up. Everybody was coming to the house of God. And in a few weeks later, everybody was gone again. When things go wrong, let's get a hold of God. But you know what God wants us to do? Serve him when things are going good. Serve him when you don't need healing. Serve him when you're not on your deathbed. Serve him because you love him and he's worthy of your praise just because he's God. Oh, let's give him thanks right now. Hallelujah, God. Thank you, Lord. This is why they came to him. They were using him. I mean, if they were coming just for the miracles, that still wouldn't be enough. Do you know, there's people, they just come for miracles. And how many remember Jesus said, not everyone that says, Lord, Lord's going into the kingdom. I'm sorry, folks, you got another thing coming to you. If just think calling me Lord is going to get you into glory. Because he says, there's going to be a lot of people that are going to say, Lord, we cast out devils in your name. We perform wonderful works. I even prophesied in the name of Jesus Christ. And he's going to say, I never even knew you. Depart from me. Now, the reason, look at, analyze the way they were talking. We cast out devils in your name. We perform wonders in you. We prophesy. They're arguing with the Lord and pointing to things that should be cause for him to bring them in the kingdom. And he says, you're not getting into the kingdom because of that. He says, after that, the ones that hear my word and do it are the ones that are building a house on a rock. Somebody say Matthew 7. That's all in Matthew 7. In other words, if you're just coming and prophesying, if you're just casting out devils and performing wonders, and you think that's going to get you to heaven, that's not a sign you're even saved. You know what's a sign you're going into the kingdom? When you hear my word and you obey my word. How many want to love God, obey his word, and say, God? And you know, they were doing it in Jesus' name. They were doing that in Jesus' name and this in Jesus' name. But the Bible says his word is above all his name. How many are glad for the word And that's what Jesus was, the Word made flesh. And you're already getting an understanding of how to feed on Jesus. This is the point. They had fed on loaves, they had fed on fishes, and they wanted more natural food. But he says, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled. Labor not for the meat that perishes, but for the meat which endureth unto everlasting life. You eat this meat, it's going to be gone. The life that you're getting from that isn't eternal. It's only temporary. You're still going to die. And the meat itself, it perishes itself. But he said, there's meat that will endure unto everlasting life. That's what you need to eat. That's why you should be coming to me, which the Son of Man shall give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed. And then they said unto him, well, what shall we do that we might work the works of God? You just told us to labor. Don't labor for meat that perishes, but for labor for meat that endures. And they said, well, what is that labor? What is that work? We want this everlasting life. I believe what you're saying. What is it? And Jesus said unto them, this is the work of God. You want to know how to labor? Here's how to do it. Believe on him whom he has sent. Everybody say, believing is the labor God wants us to perform. How many know it's not of works, lest any man should boast? You can be the best citizen in this country. You could be given the Governor General's Award for your kindness and volunteerism. I read all these stories on the news and I hear about kids getting awards in high school, and then a woman just won another award for doing what she could with the children and the kids. I interview these people, I meet them, but none of those things are going to open up the gates of glory for us. There's not works, not one work you can do that's going to bring you to glory. It's just believe on God. Somebody say faith. Say believe. This is what you need to do. You need to believe. And so in verse 29, Jesus answered and said unto them, this is the work, believe. And in verse 30, they said, well, what sign showest thou then that we may see and believe? Oh, how many remember Thomas? Here we go, Thomas all over. Actually, this happened before Thomas ever doubted what he doubted. Thomas doubted after the resurrection. Jesus hadn't even gone and died yet. And so he said, I'm not going to believe unless I see. I want to see the nail prints in his hand. I want to see the wound in his side. And when I see it, then I'll believe he resurrected. And these people say, what sign will you give us? You want us to believe you? Okay, we will believe you under one condition. You give us a sign that we can see, and then we will believe. But Jesus said, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. If you have to see before you believe, you don't really believe. Belief or faith is the evidence of things not seen. Say it again, not seen. He said it, that's all I need to know. I believe it. And when you are doing that, you are feasting on bread of life. Everybody say believe. You are getting word or bread in you that's going to endure unto eternal life. You didn't come for just liking the music. There's going to be people tonight that are going to come because they're going to like the music. There's going to be people that like to see the kids and they like to see how cute it is. And how many know it's beautiful music? It is cute to watch these children. But praise God, we're hoping that the Spirit of God's going to break through and get a hold of their hearts, and they're going to start believing. They're going to start feeding on eternal life. They're going to look at Jesus like they've never seen him before. They're going to realize why he came in a manger, because ultimately he is the bread of life in the Bethlehem house of bread for us to feed on. And the way we feed on him is believing what he said without having to see it. Hallelujah. How many want to believe like that? Praise God. What sign? Give us a sign. He said, they said, our fathers did eat manna in the wilderness. If you want to talk about food, Jesus, well, our fathers had a sign. Moses gave them a sign. They ate manna that came out of heaven. As it is written, and they started quoting scripture, he gave them bread of heaven to eat. So what do you do? What work do you do? What sign do you do? This is what Moses did. But look at this in verse 32. Jesus said to them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you," first of all, you get something straight right now. It wasn't Moses that gave you that bread. He said, "My Father is the one that gave Moses that manna and Israel that manna." Moses was just the vessel. But I'm telling you another point. My Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. You want to talk about manna? Here it is. And there he was standing in front. I am the bread. I am the true manna. That didn't mean Moses and Israel's manna was false manna because he's the true manna. When the Bible talks about I am the true vine, when he says I am the true bread, it's talking about the real bread that God wants you to have. How many know the manna in the Old Testament actually represented Jesus, the food and bread of life? Where was Israel going when they were going through the wilderness? Where were they on their way to? The Promised Land. Canaan. They come from slavery to being slaves and prisoners, and God took them out, and he whom the Son sets free is free indeed. He gave them a land to rule in. Talk about going from slavery to kingship. He gave them their own land. And when God saves them from the guttermost, he brings them to the uttermost. And so they were going to a place of kingdom. Well, we're on our way to a destination of the kingdom. Praise God. And just as the manna fed them, I'm going to show you this morning how Jesus is the bread that feeds us and show you how feeding on Christ brings us to this kingdom place with God. Amen. In fact, that's what he talked about when he said, not everyone that cries, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom. How many want to get in that kingdom? Praise God. He says, the bread of God is he which comes down from heaven and gives life unto the world. And so he was telling them, first of all, it's not Moses that gave you that bread. You're forever comparing me to Moses. You don't compare me to Moses. You need to compare me to the bread that God gave them. I am the bread. I am the true manna, he said. And if you feed on me, you'll have everlasting life. How many want to live forever? How many want to be with God? Praise the Lord. It's Jesus that's our bread. In fact, he said, your fathers, they only got a shadow of the real thing. I'm the real bread. And then in verse 34, then said they unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. It's like they were coming inches. They were getting so far with him. But they always asked him. And then when they said, evermore give us this bread, it reminds me of that woman at the well in John 4. How many remember the woman had five husbands, weren't her own? The one she was with, was, or rather, had five husbands, divorced them, got married again, and all that, looking for love. But then she said in John 4 and 15, the woman said, sir, give me this water that I thirst not, neither come hither to draw. Because Jesus just told her about living water, well, you'll never thirst again. Everybody say living water, and say bread of life. Food and drink, meat and drink. Somebody say, the body of Christ and the blood of Christ. Food and drink. Oh, hallelujah. Watch how this opens up in the word of the Lord. He said, I'm the bread. I'm standing right in front of you. They asked for it, and there he was. I'm here. And you're not believing on me. You are asking for signs. If you really believed what I was saying, you wouldn't need a sign. You would trust what I'm saying because you've got faith in me. And you would, if you would have faith in me and believe what I said, you'd feast and feast. It would get you strength. It would give you life. You'd be closer and closer every day to the kingdom. You'd be in that spiritual promised land that Israel only came to a representation of. But you're not believing. The manna was meant to keep Israel going. It was meant to keep them surviving. We need the word of God to stay surviving, folks. Amen. Come to the house of God. Get the word. Learn how to get a hold and control of your spirit. How many know the Bible teaches these things? When people are biting their tongues so they don't curse and swear, get a hold of so much Holy Ghost that he changes your heart and the word's not even in your soul to begin with that it comes out. Get control. He who has rule over his own spirit is better than a man that can take a city. And this is feeding. Your life is changing. People are seeing so much kindness in you. They're seeing so much love. Amen. And all these things come from feasting. And the more you grow like Christ, the more you're getting into that kingdom. How many know kings are in kingdoms? Yes. You got rule over your spirit? Huh? You got control over your mouth? I told you I'm going to dig in with the word of the Lord today. Praise God. Better have steel-toed shoes on because I'm going to step on some toes. In Matthew 26, Jesus talked about the blood and the bread and the wine. Actually, before I go there, John 6 and 53. Then Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, except you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Now, can you imagine a heathen hearing a man of God talk like that? What on earth is he talking about? Eating his flesh? Drinking his blood? What is he talking about? And here, they're already struggling with the fact that they just wanted their bellies full. They didn't come to even serve him. They didn't even get amazed at his miracles. They were just using him. And now he gets saying, you need to believe me. I'm the bread. And then he goes a step further. I'm going to tell you flat out, eat my flesh and drink my blood or you're not going, you'll never have eternal life. So to understand that, go to Matthew 26. And these are the verses we read when we have communion. Jesus is ready to die. The next day, he's going to be crucified. He's at the Last Supper with the disciples. And as they were eating, Jesus takes bread and blesses it. And he breaks it. And he gives it to his disciples. And he says something very strange. Take, eat. This is my body. And then he took the cup. And he gives thanks to God. And he gives it to them. And he says, drink every bit of this, every drop. Says, this is the blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. How many know when Jesus broke that bread, what did that just represent? His body being broken on the cross in death. Not a bone of his body was broken, but by death, he was broken in death. And what's it mean when he poured the wine out into the cup? What's pouring wine out represent? Shedding his blood. And so, talking about the cross, he was saying, eat this and drink this. How does that fit? What's he mean? You just said, Mike, that believing in him is how you feed. But now, how is this associating with the cross? It all comes together. Listen to me carefully. When you believe that the works of Jesus on that cross to die for you will give you eternal life, believing that is feeding on something that's going to give you eternal life. How many believe he died on that cross in your place and in mine? How many believe we could do all the good works we could think of and we'll never get to heaven? How many know that God's not looking down and saying, impress me, impress me. Do something good. Save up and get a loan and pay that poor person thousands of dollars and I'll take you to heaven. How many know it's not of good works? There's nothing you can do that's good enough to get you through those gates. The only work that God's looking for, and again, think of the Exodus. I'm not looking for your talents. I'm not looking for how good you can sing, you Israelites. I'm not looking for how much money you've got. I'm not checking to see how many good works you do before I send the death angel through this place. I'm looking for the blood, and when I see the blood, I will then pass over you. When I see that sacrifice, when I see that death, that's the only thing that's going to save you and me is the death of Jesus Christ. It's not your works, lest you should boast, but it's his faith and grace that he gave to us as a gift. Somebody say, a gift is not earned. How many are glad for the gift of eternal life? And you can't just sit and shake a preacher's hand to get this. And you just can't come into a church every Sunday and say, I'm going to glory. No, sir, you've got to grab this truth of the cross and believe it and believe it and drink it and drink it and eat it and eat it. And really with everything in you, let it affect your whole life. Let it affect the people you're around. Amen. It might come where you have to stay away from some people because they just drag you down to hell with them. It might come to that you got to get new relationships hearts. Somebody that loves God needs to rub off on me some more. Somebody that is really seeking the things of God where I struggle. I need to get around that. You need to believe this so much that your life turns around. And get this eternal life in you. Because I'm telling you, jobs are going to be gone one day. And how many know we need a job? Our vacation time's going to be gone one day. How many know you need a little break now and then? But all these things come to nothing in comparison to being right with God when your time comes and you leave this world, or if Jesus comes to sound the trumpet and take us home. That's going to count more than anything else. We can sing and sing and sing about Jesus being born in a manger. We can celebrate every Christmas faithfully. But if we don't get a hold of what that whole point was for, that he's the bread of life lying in a feeding trough in a house of bread, open our eyes and get a hold of this and feast and believe, amen, that it's the cross, the work on the cross that I'm believing. That little loaf of bread laying in that manger, the bread of life, was going to be broken one day. In the house of bread, God brought the bread of life. And that bread does nobody, anybody good if it just sits there like an unbroken loaf. But as soon as that loaf is broken, you know, oh man, the Holy Ghost is telling me something. In Acts chapter 2, when they heard Peter preach on the day of Pentecost, he said, repent, get baptized in the name of Jesus, get filled with the Holy Ghost. The promise is to you, to your children, to all that are far off. This isn't just for Israel, friend. This is for the whole world, to all that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. How many know he's calling Canadians? How many know he's calling Americans? He's calling the Chinese, the Japanese. He's calling everybody around the world. Amen. And then they said, if you keep reading, and 3,000 were baptized that day, added to the church, and they continued steadfastly breaking bread from house to house. You know what that means? They weren't just chomping on some biscuits. They were celebrating the communion and the cross of Jesus. They were drinking the wine and eating the bread. They were remembering the cross because he said, this do ye in remembrance of me. Somebody say, remember. Remember. Remember the sign of the manger. Remember who he is. He's the bread of life. And when you remember, you're remembering when he went to that cross. That's what he was referring to when he told them, break this and do it and remember me by this. Remember the cross. And you know something? That's how you get saved. And the more you serve God and the longer you serve God, you keep on feasting on his body. You keep on drinking that blood. In other words, you keep on believing the work of the cross. And this is, oh, if you get anything, get this right now. That work of the cross is when I became one with the Son. When I get baptized into his death, that is the work of God that saved me and gave me eternal life. The soul that sins has to die. Everybody say, sin brings death. And God takes all of your sins, all the whole load and burden of them, and throws them into the sea of his forgetfulness when you get baptized into Jesus Christ's death, and he remits them, and he forgives them, and he wipes them out. And now that there's no sin in you, amen, you've got his holiness. He gave you his death. He gave you his burial. He gives you his resurrection now. Somebody say, I died with Jesus. That's what you can say if you get baptized in his death. That's why Jesus said, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. If you haven't been baptized, you need to obey the word of the Lord. Get into his death, and then you get his resurrection, you get his ascension. You're one with the Son. You come into union, and when you're one with the King who's sitting on that throne, who can be against me if God be for me? I've got his righteousness. I've got his power. I use the name of Jesus to ward off demons. I use the name of Jesus to command sickness to go. I've got his power on me. And that is bringing you more into kingdom awareness, just like as they traveled closer and closer to the promised land, eating that manna every day, they were closer to that kingdom land. We're getting into that kingdom land. And those that feast on this, they're faith grows because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. You're believing, you're eating that food, and it's making you so strong in the spirit where fear doesn't affect you anymore. Anger, hatred doesn't affect you. You become so Christ-like, all because of that one day, 6 hours on the cross, that he was born to experience. When that bread was broken and the cup was poured out. And you feed and you feed and you feed. Christians that are nervous wrecks don't feed on the word enough. You don't feed on the word enough if you're fearful all the time. If things get to you in life, you're not feeding on the... There's times I realize I need to feed on the word some more. There's times I realize this shouldn't be getting to me like it is. I should have more faith than I do. And I get that by remembering I died with him. I died. The word says I died with him. Jesus said, that's right. Take a bite. Take a bite of eternal life. Feast. Eat. Drink. Drink some more. And oh, the preacher's preaching. I'm believing this. The blood heals. The blood gives me strength. Satan's scared of the blood. Let me believe. Drink, drink, and feed. I'm feasting on bread of life this morning. How many are having a good time eating today? Amen. Huh? Praise God. And so, you know what's so interesting? I noticed this one day looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 10. The first few verses, Paul the Apostle's talking to this church. He said, brethren, you can't be ignorant about something. I want you to not be ignorant about something here. We got to deal with some issues in your lives. All our fathers were under the cloud and all passed through the sea and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. How many know what he's talking about? Remember the Red Sea opened up? What name was that sea again? The Red Sea? What's red remind you of in the Bible? Blood. They got baptized in that Red Sea. Just like we get baptized into Jesus. Not only that cloud. They got baptized. You know when the cloud was leading them and then the Egyptians came right behind and then God moved that pillar of cloud? I would have liked to have felt what that must have been like when that cloud passed through them and moved behind them to block the Egyptians from taking over. They were baptized in the cloud like we get baptized in the Spirit. They were baptized in the Red Sea like we get baptized into Jesus' death. But he said, they all did eat the same spiritual meat. They all did drink the same spiritual drink. How many remember that rock that Moses struck that brought out water? They drank from that spiritual rock that followed them. And he says, guess what that rock represents? That rock was Christ. And he says, with all these things, they drank, they ate supernatural manna, supernatural water coming out of a rock. They were supernaturally passed through that Red Sea. That cloud supernaturally baptized them. But with many of them, God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. How many know they never made it in because of their doubt? Yes. And in the very next chapter, Corinthians 11, watch this. This will bless your soul. When you gather in the same place, it's not to eat the Lord's Supper. The church has something to eat too. The church has something to drink too. But with many of them, God was not well pleased. Why do you think he said that in chapter 10 before he talks about this in chapter 11? Because we might be eating and drinking, but we might not be pleasing to God. How many want to be pleasing to God? He said, you're not doing it to eat the Lord's Supper. When you eat, each of you rushes to his own supper. And one person goes hungry and another gets drunk. And in verse 23, he said, when I talked to you about communion, I received of the Lord, which I delivered unto you, that when Jesus was ready to die the next day, he took bread and he took wine. And he said, this is my body. This is my blood. You do the same thing. He says, as often as you do it in remembrance of me. How many know it's remembrance of what he did on that cross? How many are remembering the cross right now? We might be talking about his birth, but how many know it all points to the cross? Huh? Because as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you're showing the Lord's death till he comes. He tells about Israel eating and drinking, but still weren't pleasing. Now he shifts gears and says, now I'm talking to you Christians. He said, when you guys get together, you fight too much. You backbite too much. You run down the church. You run down your brother. You run down your sister. This isn't the Lord's Supper that you folks are eating. I don't care how holy you are. I don't care. Well, actually, we're not holy. I don't care how holy you try to do this, how nice you dress when we have communion service. He said, you need to be knowing that you are one body. You are one people. You're the body of Christ. If you love God, how many know you better love your brother and your sister too? You can't say you love God if you hate your brother. I opened some wide eyes a little while ago once. I remember pastoring in a church and I said, if you've got a grudge against anybody, you're lost. Oh boy, did that make it quiet there in the congregation. It got quiet that day in Dartmouth, Nova Scotia. You're lost as lost can be. I don't care how much you attend church. I don't care how much you pay your tithes and offerings. I don't care at all. If you can't get along with your brother and your sister and you just can't even look at them and shake hands with them, you are not going in the kingdom, because we are one body with the Christ, Jesus, our Lord and Savior. And we're one blood. And he said, you need to get so much of Jesus in you that you love everybody, even if they're your enemies. How many know the Bible says, bless those that despitefully use you? And I want to close and go back to John 60, chapter 6. Isn't it interesting? Chapter 6, verse 66 says something very interesting. Ever heard of the mark of the beast? Look at what, after Jesus got talking to them about this, straighten them out about why they're coming. You just want food. You're just taking advantage of me. You're not really believing me. You ask for a sign. How could you be believing on me if you ask for a sign? After he got done talking to them, look what he said. From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Oh, I didn't sign up for this. I just wanted a bit more food. You're telling me I've got to believe on you without you giving me any proof? I think I'll see you later. And walked away. And if you keep on reading, Jesus didn't stop and say, oh, okay, wait a minute. No, don't go. Let's fix this up. I didn't mean that. You ever have anybody say that to you? I didn't mean that. You can just come. I need a crowd, so come on anyway. No. He looked around at his disciples who were probably standing there. And you know what he said to his disciples? There's the door. You want to go too? Are you going to go too? And I like what Peter said. How many remember what Peter said? Peter said, Lord, where else can we go and have words of eternal life? We're not going anywhere. We love you. We serve you. We're going to obey you. Amen. We're going to follow you. We're going to eat what you're talking about. If there was any grain in me, and I think there probably might have been in Peter. How many know Peter was a rascal? Peter was a rascal. Thank God for Peter, because all us rascals got a good chance. If he could make it, you could make it. And even after he said that, he swore at the Lord, cursed three times. But the Lord still saw through him. He said, you follow me and you'll have eternal life. Remember the sign of the manger. Oh, hallelujah. How many believe this morning? How many believe? Oh, how many now know what it really means that he's the bread and how you eat that and how that gives you life? If you're here, I'm glad everybody's here for any reason. I don't care if you're just here to see how good I could sing with everybody else during the song service. Not. But you're here and you got a chance. Open your mouth, sink your teeth into Jesus Christ's word and believe every bit of it. That's why he came. This is a sign to you. He's in the house of bread. He's in Bethlehem, shepherds. And he's in a manger. And you shepherds, you're really going to get something out of this when you hear me say, he's in a manger. Because they had brought their sheep to that manger so many times in 8. And we've come to the manger today to feast on Jesus Christ. Oh, let's all stand together. Thank you, Jesus.